Thank you for joining us as Levi continues our study on the Book of Beginnings, the first book of Moses called Genesis.
With that being said, let's jump into what we're going to be covering tonight. So we're in Genesis chapter 1, the very first book of the Bible, and we're going to be starting in verse 14. Who would like to read? All right, Rocky, you got Revelation 21:23. Fernando, you got Psalms 147:4. And Darian, you got Psalms 19, 1 through 6. Genesis, we are in Genesis, starting in verse 14. Oh, let me pray. Lord God, thank you for this evening. Thank you for all that you're doing. Thank you for this time. I pray that you would bless this time and speak to us through your word. Thank you for being faithful. Help everyone who's feeling sick. Just some stuff's going around. And protect us from the evil one. And thank you for your word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Genesis chapter 1, verse 14. Then God said, "Let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons, and for days and years, and let them be for lights in the firmaments of the heavens to give light on the earth." And it was so. Then God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. God set them in the firmament of the heavens to give light on the earth and to rule over the day and over the night and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw it was good. So the evening and the morning were the fourth day. Okay, so God is fastening the stars, planets, and the moons. But notice how the earth was already there. But yet the sun, moon, and stars are being put in place. But the earth was already there. You would think all that would come first before everything else. Plus, plant life is already growing. No sun, no moon, no stars. Let's look at what Revelation says.
The revelation of Jesus Christ, chapter 21, verse 23. The city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light.
All right, because in the new heaven and earth, there will be no sun, no moon, because God is the light. So God is the light here that's giving life to everything. All right, now, got some things to point out here. We got the earth, one has been rotating, having evening and morning. Plus, remember that evening and morning also means moving from chaos to order, chaos to order, chaos to order. And then we're talking here about the sun, the moon, and the stars. So to kind of give you an idea, the sun is called in Hebrew Chama, which is transliterated H-A-M-M-A, Chama. All right, Chama. Another way to say the sun is Shemesh. All right, Shemesh. About Chama. What I find very fascinating about the part about Chama, it's very basic. Think about this. Now, for you guys who catch this. Cham. Ha. What is it? Cham. What's Cham? Not ham. Ham. You guys forgot already? What is it, Nick? He ate too many tacos. All right. Cham is hot. Hot, behold. Hot. Behold.
Sun. Sun.
And it's very simplistic. Chama. Hot, behold. I agree. Yes. So the sun, chama. Or they use the other word, shemesh, which has the word shem. All right. Shem and then shemesh. You're kind of seeing the shema. You have the sun, hot, behold. Then you have the moon. The moon's called levana. That's how they say it, Levana, which is translated L-E-V-A-N-A, L-E-V-A-N-A, Levana. Not Lebanon, Levana, which again, this one is pretty basic. It means white, behold. Very simple, hot, behold, white, behold, right? Hot, behold, white, behold, all right? Dad, what's that? Oh, that's the white. What's that? That's hot. Hot, behold, white, behold, okay? And then you have the stars. And the stars are called Kokav. Kokav, which is translated K-O-K-H-A-V, Kokav. Now, this Kokav stars. If you guys are familiar with some of the stories, you have an angel, and his name is Cocavel. Cocavel, the star of God. And he's a fallen angel. Cocavel. All right? Cocavel. Which, that name also translates to a Native American thing. Cocavel. You know the thing with the flute, with the spikes? That's that fallen angel. And the natives sing a song about hide your daughters, Cocavel's coming, because he would come down and steal the daughters of men. And they found that symbol in Israel, also Native American side. So I have met people who have that in their house. They don't realize what it is. And if you notice, it's got six spikes. The six spikes represent the six wings of a cherubim. Who's the fallen cherub?
Lucifer.
He's probably not the only one. So Cocavel, Cocav, all right? We also have here a word for planets in Hebrew, okay? And the word for planet in Hebrew is ko kochav lechet, okay? Which is again K-O-K-H-A-V, which is what?
Star.
A star. Right. But lechet means walking. So the walking star. So a planet in Hebrew is called the walking star. Why?
Because it moves.
Very good. What I want to point out here as we move forward, I'm giving you the basics, moon, star, all this. But what really fascinated me was to find how many ancient cultures actually knew about the planets. The Babylonians knew about the planets. The Persians knew about the planets and the stars. The Aztecs, the Mayans, and as you study cultures, they know. What you find too is that Israel, these ancient Israelis knew about the stars. They knew about the planets and the stars, and they had names for them. The thing is, they only had names for the first seven planets, including ours. So six outside ours, and then ours is one of them. So you got Mercury, okay? Mercury in Hebrew, they just called it Kochav, like the star, K-O-K-A-V. All right. Or sometimes they would call it the sun star because it was so close to the sun. And then I'm going to skip the one that would come next and jump to another one. And I'm going to talk about Jupiter. Jupiter, they called Tzedek. T-Z-E-D-E-Q. Tzedek means justice. So they called Jupiter justice. All right. Now, what you also find is that there is a prince in Genesis. His name is Melchizedek. Melchizedek, the prince of peace, the prince of Salem. But Tzedek is in his name. All right. Justice. All right. And then Saturn, they called it Shabbataya, which is Sierra Hotel Alpha Bravo Bravo Alpha Tango Alpha India. So let me say it again. S-H-A-B-B-A-T-A-I. And this word for Saturn has the word Shabbat in it, which is what?
Sabbath.
The Sabbath, to rest. But when you look at the word, it has the beginning of Shabbat, and then it has island in it. The rest island, the island to rest. They called it this. Now, what fascinates me is that in our world today, we have telescopes and all stuff, and we can see, and I got some videos to show you guys. But we're talking ancient times when they would look up at the sky. Obviously, they don't have city lights, so they could see a lot clearer. And they were highly intelligent people. They're not stupid people. And they knew to follow star patterns and all that. Now, you got to understand some of the ancient cultures outside Israel were all tapping into fallen angels and getting all kinds of garbage from there and lies, but tapping into powers. And then ancient Israel had who? They had God. Now, if you notice, I skipped Venus and I skipped Mars. And we're going to talk about a little bit of those. So here's the thing about Venus. What I found fascinating about Venus was this. Venus is called Kochav Noga, all right? Which again is the word star, but it means bright star, which makes sense. Who's ever seen Venus in the sky when it comes out?
Yeah.
But here's the other name that I found extremely fascinating with this. It bothers me. Should bother you too. It was this name. Halel ben Shekar.
Yeah.
Halel ben Shekar, which is Lucifer, son of the morning. They called that planet Lucifer, son of the morning. Halel ben Shekar. They give it this title of the same fallen angel. Now, if you're like, oh my gosh, there's a lot of Hebrew names. What am I supposed to do with this? Don't worry about it. If you need to, like, whoop, there goes the Hebrew names, fine. Let it be. If that fascinates you, great. And then there's this planet, Mars. All right? I saved Mars for last. There's a reason for this. Now, before we get to the details on Mars, here's the thing. I want to explain some things to you about the planetary system so you get this. Did you know that there are three pairs of a rapid spin rate among planets? So that means that there are planets that are paired up in the way they spin, okay? So in other words, each is within 3% of each other in the spin rate. You think that's an accident?
No.
No. And if it's the Big Bang Theory where we just blasted out of the sun, why do some of us ended up at 3% of a spin rate? And why are planets paired up in the way they spin? Here's the other thing. The planets that are in the rapid spin rate are these. Again, 3% of each other. These pairs are Earth and Mars. We spin the same rate together. Planet Earth, planet Mars spin at the same rate. They also have the same axis tilt, 23.5%. Jupiter and Saturn spin at the same rate. Neptune and Uranus spin at the same rate. So those are the planets that do that. All right. And then Pluto got disqualified because it's too tiny. All right. Yeah. Is it back in?
Yeah, it's back in.
Just when they thought they let him go, he's back. All right. It's a dwarf planet. Now let's look at Mars here for a minute. Mars is the fourth planet from the sun. Its name comes from the Roman god of war. Okay, this is where we get the term martial arts. It has 635,000 craters. 635,000 craters on the planet. And that's from impacts. That's not just because they're there. That's because they've been smacked around. That planet's been smacked around a little bit. 93% of the craters are on one hemisphere alone. 93% on one hemisphere alone, 7 are on the other hemisphere. When you do the mathematical calculations, really gives you some interesting insight on the planet, because for a planet to have one hemisphere smacked around that much, and you do the math, some scientists speculate that it was a 30-minute period that a ton of meteors smacked that side of the hemisphere. What happened? I don't know. But something happened. Okay? And again, do the research on yourself for that, because scientists argue on the time frame. Now, to kind of give you an idea, Earth has a little over 100 craters. So this is Mars with all its craters. They marked them. They named them. All right. This is Mars. Okay. Now, remember, Earth has a little over 100 craters. So look at this. That is Meteor Crater in Arizona. I've actually been there. All right, I was there in 2004. You may be like, okay, what's your point? Well, look at this picture. That's the road to get in, and those are the cars, and that's where you park. That gives you an impact. That was an impact that hit the Earth. And that's one of the small ones, because if you look at the one in Russia, it's even bigger. And the one in, they say it's there in Yukon Peninsula of Mexico. It's supposedly even bigger. But this one is a mile. Bender. Yes, it is over a mile. Now, here's another picture. So that's the picture of Meteor Crater from above. And again, you can see the parking facility way up here. Now, to kind of give you an idea as well, because again, this is Meteor Crater. Again, there's over 100 craters on Earth, but 635,000 craters on Mars. On Mars, okay? So something, it takes a beating, okay? Now, here's the other thing to show you about this. On Mars, there are some craters that are over a half a mile wide, but that one's a mile wide. But I want to show you this crater on Mars. That's a crater on Mars right there. All right. Looks like a snowman, not a snowman. This is called Helles Impact Crater. Helles Impact Crater. Without Googling it, Joe, without Googling it, who can tell me how wide that crater is?
20 kilometers.
No, that crater is 1,400 miles in diameter and 5 miles deep. That is taken from space. That is a huge crater, okay? To kind of give you an idea of this, as well, before I show you this next picture, I want to tell you the Hebrew name for Mars. The Hebrew name for Mars is called Ma'adim. Ma'adim. And it translates M-A-A-D-I-M. M-A-A-D-I-M. Ma'adim. Ma'adim. This is what the ancient Israelis named it. Ma'adim. Okay? What I find fascinating is many, many ancient cultures, like, they were fascinated by this place. All right, Ma'adim. When you look at the name Ma'adim, it has some meanings. Remember, because Hebrew has layers. So, I mean, on the surface, it's like blush. Why? Because what color is Mars? Red. Blush. Okay. But as you dig deeper at the name of Mars, Ma'adim, you begin to see that it means water or steam, water vapor. And then, so, but there is no water on Mars, right? If we went there, you couldn't breathe. You die, right? So actually, digging a little deeper, it's actually chaos vapor. Chaos vapor. So you got to ask yourself this. Either mankind was really, really stupid, like the history books say, and there were a bunch of, right? You know, and that's what we were doing.
You haunt me, man. Come to my cave.
Right? Or man was highly intelligent because created by God and was learning things about how everything worked. The wisest man in the Bible was, and he knew about everything. Everything. Who do you think was showing him? The Lord.
Well, God can't show you that.
Oh, you found the one thing God can't do? You put God in a box, says he can't? Right? Okay, so Ma'adim. Look at this picture. This is what the United States would look like on Mars. And that is a giant meteor track that hit the planet. Let it sink in for a minute. So that's like what? Northern California? Going through the Midwest down to Georgia? I mean, the impact on that? Massive.
That would have destroyed the whole U.S.
Yes. Planet killer. I mean, think about it. If something hit the United States that left a crater that was 1,400 miles in diameter and 5 miles deep, we would have some issues going on. I mean, if that thing hit the ocean, the Pacific Ocean, what kind of tsunami would we have? Okay. If that thing hit, let's say it's like, well, it's not even going to hit a city. It's going to hit in the middle of nowhere, Nevada. Still, the damage would be insane of what would happen. In the middle of Africa, the middle of just the Congo, Africa, the damage would be insane. We would feel the effects of the damage. Okay, now, here's what I'll show. We already looked at Revelation 21:3. Let's look at Psalms 147:4.
The book of Psalms, book 5, Psalm 147, verse 4. He counts the number of the stars. He calls them all by name.
So God counts the number of the stars. He calls them all by name. Think about that one for a minute. So do you think God knows your name? Yeah. Because if he knows the billions and billions upon stars names, I guarantee you he knows your name. So that is hope for you, that he knows your name. All right? Remember that. When you feel lonely and you're like, does God even care? He knows about stars you don't even know on the other side of the universe, and he knows your name. So there's some hope. If you remember nothing about tonight, you're like, cool, planets, Hebrew names. Thank goodness we don't have meteor problems. Remember that. And what does it tell us? If Mars, our neighboring planet, who spins like we do, who's on an axis like we do, got bombarded by about 635,000 meteors, and there's only about a little over 100 that hit our planet, what does that say about God's grace? Tons, because our universe is not safe. It's not safe, all right? That's what it tells you. Okay, now, I want to show you this video.
In September 1977, NASA's Voyager 1 spacecraft began its long journey into the unknown when it was launched from the Kennedy Space Center 16 days later than its twin, Voyager 2. The probe's main objective was to conduct close-up studies of the outer planets, including their large moons and mysterious ring systems. Voyager 1 was launched on a faster, more direct path that would send the spacecraft hurtling towards Jupiter and Saturn, while Voyager 2 would take a slightly different path that would also take it past the two gas giants, but then onto Uranus and Neptune, taking advantage of a rare planetary arrangement that only occurs once every 175 years. Within just a couple of weeks of its journey, Voyager 1 sent back its first images, one of which reveals a crescent-shaped Earth and Moon hanging in the darkness of space. This incredible image was the first of its kind ever taken by a spacecraft, and was captured when Voyager 1 was 7.25 million miles away from Earth on the 18th of September 1977. You can see the moon at the top of the image, while a blurry Eastern Asia and Western Pacific Ocean is visible on our blue planet. Because of the direct path that Voyager 1 was set on, it only took the spacecraft approximately 1.5 years to get to the first and largest gas planet in our solar system. In January 1979, Voyager 1 began taking photographs of Jupiter during its approach and captured almost 1,900 images during the flyby. This time-lapse records Jupiter over a period of 60 days and shows the gas planet's swirling clouds rotating within bright bands, exceeding any image ever taken of the planet from Earth. Incredible close-up images of Jupiter's famous storm, the Great Red Spot, was also captured like never before. By using color filters, the image reveals the turbulent nature of the giant storm, plus large white spots that surround it, as well as giving us a closer look at Jupiter's marble-like atmosphere. Voyager 1 also observed for the first time Jupiter's thin ring system, which can be seen as a faint band across the center of the picture. The edge of the ring is approximately 35,400 miles away from the planet's visible cloud deck, and the background stars in the image appear as broken hairpins due to the spacecraft's motion during the 11-minute exposure. But it wasn't just Jupiter that Voyager 1 studied. Many of the gas planet's mysterious moons were also photographed, such as the volcanic moon Io. In this image, you can see hazy details of Io's hellish surface, revealing ancient volcanic scars that are spread across the moon's landscape. Io was the first world beyond Earth where active volcanism had been observed. The huge plume can be seen silhouetted against the darkness of space on the outer edge of the moon. By using different camera filters, the close-up image also shows the moon's rich colors, which are believed to be as a result of allotropes and sulfur compounds, while the dark spots may be from lava flows or volcanic craters. Other satellites, such as Jupiter's largest moon, Ganymede, also exposed its strange surface features for the first time, revealing huge ridges, grooves, and impact craters that are spread across its icy, thick crust. After months of studying Jupiter and its moons, Voyager 1 eventually completed its flyby in early April 1979 and continued on to the second largest gas planet in our solar system. Nearly 20 months later, on the 9th of November 1980, Voyager 1 finally reached the ringed world, Saturn. This blurred image shows Saturn's dark and light bands of rotating clouds, its huge magnificent ringlets, but also two of the gas giant's mysterious moons. During the flyby, Voyager 1 also encountered Saturn's largest moon, Titan. The enhanced photograph reveals Titan's hazy, nitrogen-rich atmosphere, which led scientists to theorize that seas of liquid methane and ethane might exist on the moon's surface. which was later confirmed by the Cassini mission back in 2004. 8 hours after its closest approach, Voyager 1 snapped this picture of the planet's ring system, revealing hundreds of magnificent bright and dark ringlets that consist of trillions of small icy particles, plus larger scattered boulders. Voyager 1 collected colossal amounts of data and discovered three previously unknown moons during its flyby, but from this point onwards, its primary mission was complete, and the spacecraft would never come close to another astronomical object again. But at a distance of about 4 billion miles away, Voyager 1 was commanded by NASA at the request of the astronomer Carl Sagan to point its camera back towards the Sun one last time. In February 1990, the spacecraft captured a series of images that became known as the Solar System Family Portrait. The mosaic consists of 60 frames that, once magnified, revealed Venus, Earth, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. It is the first ever portrait of our solar system as seen from the outside. The famous photograph of Earth became known as the Pale Blue Dot, and captures our planet as a tiny blue speck in a magnificent beam of scattered light. After all of the images were transmitted back to Earth, engineers turned off the spacecraft's cameras so that it could power other instruments as it continued on its journey into the unknown. Then, on the 16th of December 2004, 24 long years after its Saturn encounter, Voyager 1 crossed the termination shock, a region where solar wind abruptly slows down and heats up as it encounters interstellar wind. Here, the spacecraft would have to travel through a turbulent area known as the heliosheath, which is the outer shell of a bubble of charged particles around the solar system. Voyager 1 finally became the first human-made object to cross the threshold of interstellar space on the 25th of August 2012. The incredible spacecraft that was only built to last 5 years is still collecting data 13.5 billion miles away from the Sun, detecting the full intensity of cosmic rays beyond our solar system. According to NASA, the spacecraft will have enough energy to power its instruments until 2021. Then, it will pass through interstellar space until it eventually comes within 1.7 light years of a star in the Ursa Minor constellation around 40,000 years from now.
So there's the picture that it took of Earth, okay? And then that is Earth right there. So this tiny, tiny little blue dot is the one it took. Teeny tiny. And it shows just how small we are. We think we're big. We think we're all that. And we're tiny, okay? And just to kind of give you another idea, look at this picture. This is a rocket launch taken from space, the photo. That's an actual rocket coming out of NASA. And it looks just like a little thing. We're very, very small as humans. But we think we're big stuff. Gee, I wonder why. Could it be because sin? Because we think we're all that? We're small. We're very, very small. Right? It looks like something out of a movie, like the movie in the 1980s where they shrunk the ship and went inside somebody. I remember.
Inner space,
yeah. Yeah. Now, I was going to have somebody read this verse, but actually I want everyone to turn to it. Psalms 19. We had read Psalms 19:1. When we had talked about the firmament, the rakia, right? And again, it says here that these lights are being put in there. The greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night, which is the what?
The moon, sun,
right? Depending how you look at it. And the stars also, and God knows every star by name. But listen to what Psalms 19 says. It says, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utter speech, night unto night reveal knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. You catch that? There is no speech or language their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out throughout all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoices like a strong man to run its race. Its rising is from one end of heaven, and its circuit, catch that word? Circuit. What do you think that word circuit is? Circuit. Yeah, but what do you think it is in Hebrew? Remember, we talked about it. The highest circuit that we see that works, the what? The rakia, the firmament, all right? And its circuit to the other end. There is nothing hidden from its heat. Now, listen to this. Either this is really poetic stuff, or it's literal. Okay? So look at it very carefully. The sun declares the glory of God. Either that's poetic, or it literally declares the glory of God. And the firmament shows his handiwork. Would you agree that the firmament, the sky, shows the handiwork of God? Yes. Who's here been camping where there is like no city lights and you can just see stars for miles? It's amazing to see. Who's been to a third world country where there's no distractions, there's no glamping, and you're just like, whoa, I didn't even know there was many stars. Yeah. All right. Who grew up in the city? First time you went out to where there was a bunch of stars, how was it? It was amazing, right? Yeah. So it does declare his handiwork. Now listen, day unto day utter speech, and night unto night reveal knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not. Whose voice?
Voice of the planets.
There you go. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chambers, and rejoices like a strong man to run its race. Its rising is from one end of heaven, and its circuit is to the other end, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. But notice how it says that there's a voice, how they all declare God's glory. We can look at that and be like, well, yeah, I've been camping in the middle of nowhere. I mean, it's gorgeous, right? I mean, that's where I proposed or whatnot, or it was an amazing, you know, or it was the worst time ever because there was ticks and mosquitoes and you absolutely hate it. All right, so, but here's the thing. It says here, they utter speech. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. I'm going to show you this video here. We're going to end here with this video. I want to show you this, how, what they have discovered about this, okay? through all the planets. They make different noises. Our planet, it sounds like it's just all our activity is coming off the planet and making a bunch of noise, right? Cars and planes and everything. But some of them make the weirdest sounds. Like Saturn, it sounds like a bunch of screaming going on, and your imagination can run with it and what it sounds. Like my wife, when she heard it, she said that it was Neptune that sounded like an ocean. And but yet the word of God said that they make noise, they sing, they speak.
Maybe the Vela Pulsar got wind somehow innately of Psalm 148 verse 3, and says, it says, praise him, sun and moon and all you shining stars. We're a shining star, we should praise him. Well, how are we gonna praise him? I know, let's oscillate 11 times a second on our axis and see if we can send a radio signal into the universe that would join in the symphony of God's praise from all creation. It's singing. The stars are singing to him. I recently stumbled on 47 Tuck. It's a beautiful cluster of stars. We'll show you the picture of it here. There are 12 of these super giant blue stars in there. But the things that are of interest to us tonight are these millisecond pulsars. And right now tonight, while we're sitting in this room, the 16 recorded millisecond pulsars in 47 Tuck are making this sound right now. That one's a little out of tune. Beautiful. Who knew? You know, God has his own string section. Isn't that beautiful? And we just looked at 11 times a second pulsar and 16 millisecond pulsars, and you start seeing Psalm 48 come to life. But look down at verse 7. It says, praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures in all deeps. The whale songs could sound like this right here. Take a listen. We don't know the expanse of the worship that is continually surrounding the throne of God. And our songs are great, but God isn't banking on our songs because he is surrounded by a symphony that's bigger than our wildest dreams tonight. Stars sing and whales sing and the birds fly. And I just tried to imagine what would it sound like if you could just for a second be God and hear what he hears. And I can't get us there tonight, but I came close. I had a friend who helped me with this little iPad program, and I'm not a DJ, but a little thing, just quickly, and I want you to see how this works. Now, this guy, we didn't look at his picture. He's PSR-B0329-54, and he's only rotating 1.5 times per second, which is not all that much, but we need him in our little experiment we're going to do here, okay? And then we had the Vela Pulsar. You remember the Vela Pulsar, right? So that's that guy. But that's a little too fast for what we're trying to do, so we're going to slow that down, okay? And so we're going to put the millisecond guys in there, the ones you just heard. Here they come. Undoctored and unedited. Here they come. and then 16 others in some whales, and we got something going. But I was asking what you're asking, because some people need it really clear. Like, what are they singing? And we tried this, and you just got to know this is unedited. We just dropped this on, and this is what happened. This is what they might be singing.
Again, Psalms 19 says that the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, night unto night reveals knowledge, and there is no speech, no language where their voice is not heard. I found that video years ago. I thought it was really fascinating what he did. And when I originally had played it, what I did was is I played it for people who do music on certain levels. And before he even played the track over it, three of the people turned around and went, "Whoa, I know that song." They picked it up right away. Even my daughter did it when I showed her. She picked up what song that was right away. So it's very fascinating that that's what it is. But I showed you the previous video with all the planets. You're hearing these noises and you're just like, your imagination runs. You're like, "Oh, it's screaming. That's air. That's..." When it's all put to a level we understand, it's something like that, right? So this little section here, it just kind of gives us an idea of our solar system, how small we are, right? We can go back to that picture of how tiny we are. The fact that ancient cultures were intelligent and knew about other planets, that Israel knew about the other planets, you know? I'm not suggesting anything crazy or conspiracy. I'm not going there. That's not what I'm saying. I think basically what it comes down to is if you serve the Lord and you study scripture and you spend time with the Holy Spirit, guess what's going to happen? He's going to reveal things to you because he reveals his scripture to you. And his scripture is full of everything that it talks about. There's nothing new under the sun. That's what Ecclesiastes tells us. So think about these things. Let them sink in. And if your brain hurts, great. Next week, we will be moving on to the next section of creation. But as for right now, let's close in prayer. Lord God, thank you for this evening. Thank you for your word and how awesome this is. Man, we are so, so tiny. Because of our nature, we think we're all that. We think we're the center and everything, and Lord, we're nothing, and it puts it in perspective. Lord, thank you that, yeah, we were enemies of you. You died for us. Jesus paid the penalty for us, and Lord, you loved us. Before the foundation of the earth were laid, Lord, you paid that price for us and wanted us. Thank you for all that you've created, and thank you for everything you've given to us through your creation, and just things we could be in awe about, and things that you take care of us, and just, Lord, how you meet our needs. Keep us safe tonight as we go home. Protect us. Keep your angels around us. And Lord, we bless you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.